Abbiamo sfidato un monitor quando tutto era virtuale. Ora siamo qui, insieme, pronti a ritrovarci là fuori, dentro alla vita. Abbiamo sfidato un monitor quando tutto era virtuale. Ora siamo qui, insieme, pronti a ritrovarci là fuori, dentro alla vita.
Civiltà dell'amore, fratelli e sorelle, costruite senza stancarvi mai questa civiltà. Lavorate per questo, pregate per questo, soffrite per questo.
Davvero, davvero buongiorno a tutti.
Good morning everybody. Today we are here at the very beginning of this electoral campaign here in Rimini, and the topic that we will focus on today is suggested by the Subsidiarity Group is diversity for the common good. And here we have a lot of diversity for sure. So we will try to give the floor to everybody, of course. Of course, this meeting had been scheduled and planned when the electoral campaign was not even an idea, nor for Italians, nor neither for Italians, nor for the leaders that are here on the stage with us today. So there's been an unexpected crisis and a very, let's say, original electoral campaign, which takes place during the summer period. And also a traumatic event, the end of the Draghi government, which was supported by a large majority in parliament. And that happened in a period in which Italy is dealing with two important situations, the pandemic on the one hand and the war on the other hand, which are still happening today. And these are the topics I think that the winners of the next elections will have to immediately deal with in terms of economical consequences, social consequences, and also international roles and international approaches. So I don't want to spend too much time with the introduction because we are slightly late already. I see that despite the hard work for preparing the list for the electoral campaign, you are now ready to face the real problems, the ideas that you have for Italy, for our country, because that's what we actually need. So we will focus on the topics that the Intergroup for Subsidiarity would like to approach and discuss with the main leaders of the parties that will take part in the electoral campaign. Let me just introduce our guests. I'm sure you all know them, but just a brief introduction. Luigi Di Maio, founder of Together for the Future, Impegno Civico. Enrico Letta, National Secretary of the Democratic Party. Maurizio Lupi, President of the Parliamentary Intergroup for Subsidiarity. Giorgia Meloni, National President of Fratelli d'Italia. Ettore Rosato, National President of Italia Viva. Matteo Salvini, Federal Secretary of the League. And Antonio Tajani, Vice President of Forza Italia. We will talk about topics and issues that the meeting would like to focus on. So let me leave the floor to Giorgio Vittadini for an introduction, president of the Foundation for Subsidiarity. The three topics I'd like to focus on are kind of weird for an electoral campaign. The first one concerns the nature of the parties themselves, which may have three different points of view. The first one is the so-called romantic vision that we have, for which yesterday we called this meeting with Giuliano Amato, democracy and truth. And truth is involved, should be involved with the politics. And however, yesterday the President Amato agreed with us, saying that we need to start from the truth of facts. So that's a kind of a provocation for parties, starting from the real truth of facts. And that's not something to be taken for granted. But this truth of the facts, as Giuliano Amato was saying yesterday, needs to be supported by social supporters. And he said the parties play a key role within this context. And today, also social realities and intermediate bodies are involved, because thanks to the Intergroup, we I remember in the past we had Letta and Lupi were the presidents, and we brought President Napolitano for a show called 150 Years of Subsidiarity, because our idea is that Italy is made out of these social realities, movements, associations with a bottom-up approach. Only the third sector today accounts for 375,000 associations, with accounting for more than 4 million people, the people that subscribed to the parties in the past. And meeting after meeting, they've been increasing, supporting the healthcare system, welfareism, energy field, and so on. So why is that important for politics? Because the relationship for Subsidiarity 2022 showed the relationship between the intervention of social issues and the well-being of people. Think about the fact that, you know, the labor rate is connected, the subsidiarity engagement employment indicator on a scale from 0 to 1 achieves a value of 0.7, and people are committed and engaged, who are committed and engaged for this kind of activities, are more likely to find a job. There is also a lower poverty rate and mortality rate for people taking part in these associations, in these realities. So it means that if there is no public expenditure for these kind of activities, there won't be an improvement in the life of people. So I'm relying on official data published by the Istat institutions. So considering this reality, this context, means contributing to the well-being of the country, because that's the way to educate our reality, our commitment. That's the place where the real commitment becomes reality. So that's a topic which plays a very important role. And then the third part, it concerns parties. As Giuliano Amato was saying, the parties have been created as a relationship with these intermediate bodies, so as a key part of them, as a pillar. And I think today they play an even more important role, because in order to actually understand the needs, you need to rely on that. You cannot understand what poverty is if you don't consider what Caritas or Banco per la Povertà tell you. You cannot understand the environment and the nature if you don't deal with the WWF or other associations working in this field. So I think parties shall be more and more involved with this within this context. And that's my question, starting from a bottom-up approach, which is extremely important. And in my opinion, congresses are fundamental, because it's important to debate, to have a debate and discuss with real people the line to be followed, not just on TV talk shows. And again, another provocation, we need people to be allowed to choose their representatives. And that's not what what's happening. It's no longer happening nowadays. And finally, the role of Parliament, because the wonderful experience we had with all the groups over the last few years is the role of the Parliament. There is a government, there will be someone at the position, but it's important within the Parliament to have people debating and developing real laws with a real dialogue. This is the real value of a democracy. Otherwise, we will miss one of the three pillars of our democracy. So this is the setting, the configuration. So the first question is, what do you think about this image of the party? Why is that important? Because it seems to be secondary compared to the to your programs. But if you don't focus on that, how can you fill the gap of people no longer being interested in the politics? People want to feel this approach. And then the second question, of course, there are many topics to be discussed, but we are people, we are human beings, and the most important, the greatest resource of our country is the human resource. So from this point of view, the second question concerns schools. So have a look at that, 543,000 dropouts every year, 2 million of the so-called needs. 17% of graduated people between 25 and 64 years old are part of these needs. And it's much, much different from other European countries, the situation. So if we consider the fact that within the next five years, we still don't know what will be the future jobs, and there is a need of graduated people. So that's a national emergency. We didn't achieve the goals in 2010, and we need to invest more in a new and renewed school, allow understanding that we shall invest on personalities. We're talking about creativity. We can no longer talk about bureaucratic schools. It should be equal for everybody, of course, but in terms of results, not in terms of starting points. There are some regions today that are scoring behind the national average with the INVALSI tests. So what kind of investments do we need today? Not only money, but quality as well. And then the third question, the labor market. We are still convinced that the first article of our constitution is that our republic is based on the labor market, on work. And it's not true that over the last few years we have been investing on the labor market, because if we consider the poverty rate, we find that there's still a very high level of welfareism, and the neoliberalism as well is bringing poverty and lack of jobs and very poor salaries, is bringing huge inequalities. Neoliberalism is not good. It's been defeated. From a cultural point of view, we need something new, something different, more linked to the Italian tradition. And secondly, welfareism. It's true that we need to support and help people who are more, let's say, who are poorer. But we cannot think this is just the solution and a tool for the labor market. We need to rely on more active and proactive policies for the labor market. So investing on the companies that are giving jobs, exporting, creating something new, providing a support for a continuous training, continuous learning. This is a kind of a revolution. And let me conclude by saying that this idea of school, relationship between school and job, is something subsidiary. So this is, we need a dialogue there with social realities, with professors and teachers that are getting very poor salaries, and increasing and improving equality in free schools. That's what Berlinguer used to say. So involving all the schools and the institutions that can provide a job and a relationship with the job. So these are the questions I'd like to ask you. And I'd like to conclude by saying that we are not judges for parties. We are not here to say that parties are bad or good. Parties are fundamental for democracy. And I'm saying that because we really hope that also in the next, with the next government, this wonderful experience of the intergroup, we will keep on having this dialogue with all of you, because we believe that the diversity in our country and your presence as well, all of you, all kinds of presences, are the basis for the most important element for democracy, which is not present in other countries. Thank you. Thank you, Giorgio Vittadini. You introduced a lot of very interesting topics. You said three topics, but maybe there are some more topics to be analyzed. So let's start the first round of answers. So please keep in mind you have 4 minutes each, and after 4 minutes I will tell you that you'll have to leave the floor to the next guest. So the first topic is, will you be able to face this challenge in a responsible way? So will you be able to give back the role of parties to what it should be? So basically representative, being very careful on the social reality, on the anxieties and concerns of people, and also on the frustrations of the citizens. And we are saying that at the end of a government, that at been declared to be the craziest in the world. We saw all kind of alliances. We started from an idea where parties were no longer present. They were kind of finished, and the parliament as well was something to be radically changed. So I'd like to ask you to answer to this question, starting from a remark concerning what an important businessman told me before this meeting. A few months ago, I had trust in this situation. Then I started thinking about how I had to organize myself, and now I no longer know what to do and what I shall look for the future. Not talking about a small company, but a company with an international approach. So the role of parties, how will parties face this situation? Do you think we'll move on after the craziest government of the world? So starting in alphabetical order from, I leave the floor to Luigi Di Maio. Thank you. I'm very pleased to be here, and I'd like to answer to your question by saying that if parties won't be able to do that, we'll see, as it happened over the last few years with the pandemics, we will see further development of the third sectors, because where politics fails, citizens will organize themselves alone, and they try to find answers to the problems that are growing, and sometimes there are also new problems to be faced. Thinking about the businessmen, I've been dealing with that, many of them over the last 3 years, and we are proud of them because in 2021 we achieved the highest record of export in Italy, from Italy, and we never achieved such a high result like last year. And this year the data are still positive, but now our country is suffering from new issues, new problems like price of energy. We have companies that last year, in the month of August, were paying, let's say, 200,000 euros for the energy bill, and this year, the same period, they're paying about 1 million euros. So this is not sustainable. And let me say, this is the I believe this is the reason why the government shouldn't have been stopped in such a critical period from the energy point of view, but also during the Ukraine war. And now we can no longer wait. We cannot wait for the new government to solve this issue, because we will have to wait until the end of October. While, let me say that we need to move faster, and we need to win in Europe the battle for the maximum price of the cost of gas, because as a government we signed new agreements to reduce the dependency from Russian gas from 40% down to 15%. But when we sign agreements with Algeria or other countries, we are not agreeing the price, because the price is agreed by the so-called TTF in Amsterdam. So being aware that today the price accounts for 300 euros for megawatt per hour, when before the crisis this price accounted for 40 euros per megawatt per hour. So it means there is a huge speculation on the bills nowadays, with this crazy run in Amsterdam where they are playing with the life of families and companies. So this is the fight we need, the battle we need to fight in Europe. And we need to be aware of the fact that Italy cannot stay without Europe, because if we want to have a change on the price of gas, we need to interact with that Amsterdam price, with the European regulation. And I hope that we will be able to face this situation together, facing this battle together, because this means saving the life of our family, but also the competition and competitiveness of our companies that, of course, import raw materials that they will then process and then export the finished product. The current energy price is not sustainable. We cannot wait for the end of the electoral campaign in order to achieve this goal. And we, as Impegno Civico, and also as a member of the previous government, we need to do all our best in order to achieve this goal. Thank you.
Enrico Letta.
Now the floor to Enrico Letta. Well, first of all, thank you for this invitation. Thank you, really, of been coming to the meeting for many years. And I must say that today I feel very emotional to be here as the pro tempore secretary of a political party. I'm very glad to be here as the secretary of a political party, and I'm here to learn a lot of things. And I'm sure that also today I will go out of this room knowing that I have learned something new from your passion, thanks to your passion, and thanks to all the things that you represent. Well, I'd like to reply to your questions in a very straightforward way. Well, first of all, I'd like to reply to Director Fontana, and also I'd like to, reply to what Di Maio said, which I agree, actually, I agree with. We have to make an exception to the rules. You know, when the price of gas and the price of energy exceeds the previous price by 1,000%, it means that we're not following the rules anymore, and we have to absolutely act. We have to do something to make sure that for 12 months we have controlled prices in Italy. We need to have a maximum price for the gas bills, for electricity bills. This is the only way if we want to stop this growth, these rising costs and prices. So we need to do something from a legal point of view. We have to make a law, and if we do it immediately, we will also have a direct, immediate effect. Well, at the moment, gas and electricity, electrical energy from renewable sources and also fossil fuels, well, they are coupled together. And this is why on the market we have these unbearable, unaffordable prices. My proposal is to do something right now. We need to have controlled prices with a much lower maximum threshold if we want to help families and companies. If we don't do that, our system will just fail, because Putin's strategy is to strangle Europe and European countries with these strategies, with these rising prices. I'd like to tell you something else. Actually, I'd like to say that there will be, you will see that there's a difference between my voice and the voice of the other leaders. My voice is the voice of the secretary of a party, and you will see on the ballot paper, you will see that there will be the symbol of the political party, but not my name. All the other symbols will also have the name of the people next to the symbol, so the people that are around me. And this is our choice, the choice of our political party. We are a community of people. It's not just one leader. We are a community of people. And so, you know, the fact that we are a community of people, this is the choice that is in line with our Italian constitution, a constitution that has allowed us to have, our country based on the parliament, the role of the parliament. If we win, our constitution will be safeguarded. We will implement Article 49 on political parties. We want the third sector and social associations and social bodies to be even stronger. But if we don't win, we will do our best to make sure that our country will not become a presidential country. We don't want our constitution to be changed. The constitution was given by our founding fathers. Our constitution is based on the central role of the parliament, and we want to keep that. This is our promise, and we will keep it. This is what we will commit ourselves to in the next few months, and I'm sure that Italian people will believe in us and will understand us. Thank you.
Aggiungo, prendendo anche un po' spunto dalle cose.
Well, I'd like to add a few things. First of all, with regard to the controlled price of energy, Of course, the government can do it. Political parties can do something in order to have that. And so I think this is a very important topic. And also, well, you know, presidentialism, the proposal for presidentialism. Thank you for mentioning that. And you know that someone is actually proposing presidentialism. Well, first of all, thank you. Thanks, everybody. Thank you. I'd like to thank the meeting. Thank you for hosting these meetings for the last 20 years, these meetings for subsidiarity. Well, I'd like to go back to Giorgio Vittadini's question. You know, actually, Giorgio Vittadini's question is not abstract. It's not just a theory or abstract, and it is actually related to school work and the life in our country. The reason why I decided to commit myself into politics is something quite basic. Well, first of all, I'd like to remark that I read on the newspapers that at the meeting there should be less politics and more culture. I was educated knowing that politics should be the highest form of culture. And the fact that there are so many of you here listening to us today, well, this means that, you know, we don't need less politics, but rather we should understand and ask ourselves what kind of politics do we want? What kind of responsibilities are politicians ready to accept? I remember that 100 years ago, a priest, well, before founding a party, he did something very simple, the reason why we're here, actually. So he traveled for 7 years all around Italy, and he met all the realities from associations to banks, companies, enterprises. He was Don Sturzo, and then he founded the popular party, Partito Popolare. We need to go back to finding links with the civil society. We need to understand that the politics has to reply needs, find an answer to problems. And we need to find a way to solve people's problems, because otherwise we will be too far away from that. Well, and at the same time, we have to guarantee freedom, your freedom. And otherwise, this would be a very big mistake. We don't want to make this big, huge mistake. So why do we need to talk to the intermediate bodies, to all social classes? Well, let's close our eyes thinking that tomorrow we may have all the volunteers associations of Italy in Italy closing down. We have 8,000 municipalities, so at least we have around maybe 60,000 volunteers associations. Without them, how would be the organization of our regions, of our municipalities? How would it be like in our country, our state, in terms of helping poverty, sports associations, helping the disabled, providing help, support to the weakest? This is our, well, this is what we are facing at the moment. Therefore, we want the parliament to be the place where we defend the real interests of our society. We want to represent the interests of our society. At the moment, you know, representing an interest in this country seems to be a crime. Well, this is crazy. You know, representing interests has to be the core of the parliament, of politics, for the common good. So, you know, the parliament must work at the service of the common good. So this is why we have to go back to this relationship with the civil society. With each one of us, with our diversities, we wouldn't have the parliamentary intergroup if there were no differences. And last, Draghi government was the biggest act of real politics, of the big good politics, for those who supported it, the majority of us. But then, well, you know, there were also people, some political parties that were at the opposition. You know, when we are in democracy, it's very good to work for the common good, but you can contribute to the common good if we work all together. With regard to energy, we're facing the largest emergency. the biggest emergency just after COVID. In September, the risk is that our enterprises will not open again. This is why we need to have a maximum roof on the prices of energy. And Draghi can still do it with the contribution of all political parties. We have to act now quickly with an extraordinary measure and decision in order to allow small and medium enterprises in our country and freelancers also to survive, because this is the dignity of our country. Thank you.
No. Giorgia Meloni.
Giorgia Meloni. Well, first of all, a very good morning to all of you. Thank you for the very kind invitation. This is my first time at the meeting. Thank you. And well, I'm very glad to be here. I'm very glad to see all of you here. This is a meeting that I that I've been following for many years, and I'm so happy to be here. You know, well, I would like to go a bit deeper into the facts. You know, politics nowadays don't go deep into the problems. Even if we are facing problems like the pandemic, there were many severe problems that force us to go deeper and deeper in order to rediscover the founding principles of our society. We need to find answers to problems that have come up, that will have emerged in a time period where we thought that our well-being was to be taken for granted. But instead, you know, the topic of intermediate bodies, I think that's very important. It's very simple. The church doctrine, social doctrine, tells us that civil society is not just a bunch of individuals, but actually it is the union of all the relations and links that the people have with the intermediate bodies. What does that mean? Well, it means that it is actually, all these links, the relationships that we have within the society, that is what matters. The fact that you are aware that the others are expecting something from you, this is what produces virtuous behaviors. Why am I saying this? I founded my party 10 years ago when people said that we didn't need to have larger political parties. We thought that a political party could be governed just by an online platform, just existing on Facebook. But instead, I decided that I needed to found a political party that has its headquarters really existing on the territory. Because I think that a political party needs to have people actively participating in it. Of course, you can still participate online, but the approach is very different. When you have to relate yourself with a Congress and you have 5,000 people in front of you in real flesh, blood and flesh in front of you, it's much more difficult than having a Facebook event with 5,000 people that you don't see. And therefore, there are different expectations. There's a different relationship with those people. And as Fratelli d'Italia, my party is the only one that had the courage to have citizens choose members of parliament. So this is my party is the only one that had the courage to do that, to have citizens choosing the members of parliament. A member of parliament that is elected by people has to reply back to those citizens, takes a real responsibility towards those citizens. This is a consistency. But without political parties, without intermediate bodies, this wouldn't be possible. I don't agree with the issue of presidentialism. I think that we should have the citizens at the center of choices. We had parliaments exactly the opposite as what citizens were asking for in the last few years. This is not what democracy means from my point of view. We need to have something direct, a direct relationship between voting, so citizens and the government. We need stability. We paid the consequences for our political instability. Governments continuously collapsing and being set up again in this country. Instead, I think that we need to have a constitutional change in Italy. Well, and also, well, you know, presidentialism, the fact that people say that presidentialism is not acceptable. Do you think that France is not acceptable? It doesn't seem to be, well, so bad. It seems to be in line with Europe, totally in line with Europe. Do you have 30 seconds to talk about energy, please? I totally agree with a price cap at European level, but let's be careful when we think about imposing the price cap at national level, because our companies are not public, they are listed on the stock exchange, and so let's be cautious. And the markets are all interconnected, so what shall we do? Shall we put the money in order to have the French or German will buy energy at 100, well, and shall we pay for that? This is it. Well, Luigi Di Maio, it's exactly the opposite. We don't want to be without Europe, but if the situation is the current one with regard to energy, well, this is because Europe was busy with totally different issues when instead we were asking Europe to solve the energy problem. So thank you.
Ettore Rosato, naturalmente.
Ettore Rosato, well, you know, probably you would like to say something about the law, the election law, the voting law. So can you tell us something about that? Well, thank you. First of all, I'd like to greet the meeting. I'd like to meet, to greet the hundreds of volunteers who welcome us every year with their smile. Thank you, Giorgio Vittadini, for your great job. Thank you for what you've been doing in all these years. And also thanks, Maurizio, Lupi, because, you know, you managed to keep us united, more than 200 members of parliament, and thank you for what you've done. We have done things that are very useful for the country, and so thank you. Well, you know, with regard to the electoral law, this was the most voted electoral law in the history of the Republic. And well, do we think that we could have a better electoral law? For sure, yes. And for sure, we could do a lot of things in order to change this electoral law. Unfortunately, during the with the last governments, we didn't manage to change the electoral law. And constitutional reforms are needed. I'm not scared to do that. We're not scared to discuss about presidentialism. Direct election of the president of the council, and but if we want to have a constitutional reform, so of course we will have to join forces. We will have to work all together, and well, if the next legislation manages to do this, it will be a very important legislation for the country. Today, you know, the second part of the constitution is not. Not right enough for the challenges that we are facing at the moment. But I'd like to go back to some other topics. You know, I'm in love with politics. We couldn't have politics without political parties. And nowadays, the institutional crisis we had to face is due to the inability of parties to be good political parties. We don't have to be scared of leaderships in politics, and you can't decide who the leaders are just sitting at a table. You have to be able to talk to the citizens, say you have to explain what the future will be about. You have to explain that there's a project for our country. This is how you can be a leader, and this is what political parties should be based on. And political parties should also be political communities. If they are not such communities, they will fail, because otherwise they will just disassemble. And political parties have been conceived as realities that should join the hearts, the ideas of people who manage to build projects by overcoming differences. Nowadays, we have politics that is based on the last century heritage, always looking for differences, always looking for clashes. Instead, politics should, as I said, join forces by overcoming differences. I think that it's now time for a new political debate. During the emergency, during the pandemic, we managed with Conte's government. And I think that Conte's government was not adequate enough, I think. At the same time, we managed to face the emergency at that time all together. And then Draghi was much better than Conte. He was able to unite all of us together, left-wing parties and right-wing parties, in order to overcome the emergencies that Italy was going through. And Draghi managed to do that. Draghi managed to allow Italy to be a totally different country during the emergency. Unfortunately, Draghi had to face some people who had their own personal interests. With regard to the European price cap, this was something that was proposed by Mario Draghi, first of all. And unfortunately, with these early elections, Draghi couldn't continue with his program. I think that September will be a very decisive month from this point of view, and all the political parties will have to express their opinion. Well, I know that there will be some differences, different opinions with regard to technical aspects, but we have to address Europe, saying that the price cap will be something very important for the survival of our country.
Matteo Salvini.
Innanzitutto,
first of all, thank you for the people who are here with us in the audience, and also for those that are connected from remote. Let me start from the question of Vittadini. Well, let me say that we as a league, we have more than 1,400 offices at the local level. We have 800 mayors working this morning, and within our list, we decided to award many of these mayors from the north to the south. Politics should be brave enough to take some choice, to make some decisions that cannot be the best ones. So let's start from the meeting here, because politics deserves knowledge, to listen to the people and to be brave enough to make choices. I want to support life, and there are people, some of my consultants, that sometimes tell me that I need to be careful not to lose votes, but since I'm working in the politics and this is my job, and I want the Italians that will choose us to know exactly what we will do. There are very tangible topics: taxes, work, job, labor market, school, and there are some values that cannot be negotiated for me. The first one is to protect life from the very beginning to the end. So supporting the centers that support life. These are one of the most important things we have in Italy. 260,000 children that are born from 1965 until today that otherwise wouldn't have been born. So applying completely the law 194, allowing the women to decide to give birth to their baby despite not having the economic conditions allowing them to do that. So supporting life in all their forms. Yesterday there's been a debate here in Rimini, focusing on a very brave choice, where according to which a civil country shall offer to everybody to rely on support and health care services also at home 24/7 in Italy, and also to rely on palliative cares. And then there is another topic which from which I completely disagree with our friends of the political, the PD or the Cinque Stelle. And I'm talking as a father of a 19-year-old son and a daughter as well. I will never manage a country that will allow to consume and to sell and to distribute drugs and illegal substances. For me, illegal substances and drugs are death. And it's completely responsible to say that there are some drugs that are not dangerous. All drugs are killing, either sooner or later. And I think that 16-year-old young people have the entire life in front of them and shall have the possibility to enjoy the life with no illegal substances. So we shall offer our young people the opportunity to have a good life in front of them. So I'm not afraid by the fact that 16-year-old people will not vote for me. Maybe they won't do that today, but in the future they will thank me, because life shall be lived every day from the morning till the evening in a good and correct way. And then let me talk about the energy. It's okay to have the price cap. And these are all battles on the end of life, on the other topics that I collect the feedback from the reality, from churches, from communities where there are people involved. And there is another topic I'd like to focus, apart from the price cap in Italy or in Europe or on renewable energy sources. In this moment, all over the world, there are 100 nuclear plants, plants that are safer and more green. So if Italy wants to be an independent country also from an energy point of view, we cannot be the only big country in the world that still says no to the safe and clean modern nuclear power. We need to rely on clean and safe energy. We need nuclear power. Antonio Tajani, considering the important role of Europe, well, this price cap we are talking about for the price of gas, I think will never happen, considering the debate we are in right now. Well, thanks. First of all, let me thank to the meeting organizers, and also thank you for to Vittadini for finally having brought the political debate on real serious topics, the only ones that citizens are really looking for. We took part in many debates that I think people who participated in those debates and saw those debates won't go to vote, maybe. So I think that a political party deserves to exist only if that party bases its existence on the real vision of the society. Otherwise, it's only something made for private, personal interests and not for the interests of other people. So what is the value, the fundamental value that we aim at? That each one of you, the person, we were not born to live alone, we have not been created to live alone, but we have been created, for those who believe in that, to stay together. But each one of us is different from the other. Each one of us is fundamental. Or even the poorest person, even the people suffering from very serious handicap or disabled or all kind of people are fundamental for the coexistence. So every political choice should be aimed at providing an answer to every single individual. And when we say that we need to tackle the price increase for energy, are we saying that because we believe in strange and weird economic ideas, or is that because we know and we realize that there are families struggling to pay such a high price for gas and energy? When we say that we need to increase the amount of money that we recognize and we pay to the pensions that we pay to aged people or disabled people, we say that because we know that there are people struggling to get to the end of the month. So, leave apart the so-called reddito di cittadinanza, and we shall give the money to the people that are working, because who is able to work shall go to work. And when we say to that we shall increase the pensions to disabled people, we are saying that because there are families that are really concerned for what will happen to that individual that, despite having some difficulties in his life, is still playing a very important role in their life, in the world. And once the parents will no longer be there, who will take care of these disabled people? That's where the state shall intervene. When we protect little banks, cooperative banks, popular banks, why are we doing that? Because these are the banks that allow to have access to credit to small companies, to people working, which are not just figures based on the mathematical calculations without actually knowing those people, those persons. So all choices are actually conditioned by the willingness to provide the support and help to those people. That's the way a party really gets a meaning. Otherwise, it only becomes a tool for the power. And as our constitution says, there is a link between citizens and institutions, and we need to be aware of that. And let me conclude by talking about the price of energy, which is a topic which, of course, concerns families. And we are in favor of the nuclear power, or also of alternative energy sources. And we are in favor also of the price cap. This is a battle we need to fight. It's useless to say Europe is far away and it's Europe deciding. No, we are there in order to fight, in order to protect the interests of 60 million Italians, which are a very important part of Europe. So the price of gas shall be agreed, and it should be a political battle that all political parties shall fight in order to try to persuade, to convince Europe that this is something fair, this is something needed in order to protect the interests of 450 million European people. We will now move to the next question. And I will start mentioning the second remark that Vittadini made at the beginning. So we talk about young people, we are talking about education. We saw the data, and let me say that I looked at your programs, I saw some proposals, some ideas, but apart from some chapters that just say investing on education, training, I didn't actually understand how you are planning to increase the number of graduated people, or how you will increase the technical and scientific skills in our school, or how you're gonna develop this so-called STEM programs for women, which is one of the topics concerning gender inequalities. So I'd like, if possible, to try to be more accurate in order to provide information about what you will actually be able to do, because this is what people in this moment is asking for. Please tell us something serious that you can actually achieve, and that will lead us to grow, and it's not just the illusion of a moment. So, Antonio Tajani, again, it's your turn. So as I was saying, those who can go to work shall work. So creating job opportunities and provide the young people the opportunity to be able to work. That's a matter of skills, opportunities, and training. So we shall invest more in education, training, and strengthening the relationship between school, universities, and companies. So promoting jobs means reducing taxes for the companies, especially taxes hiring young people. And because hiring young people, it means relying on a training education period, as it is for Germany or in France. And I already said that when I was commissioner for the industry, because all over Europe, we shall aim at the same system. I saw young people being hired in some companies just because when they were students, they made the experience of having an internship in that company for a couple of years. So we need a reform for vocational institutions, and we shall also focus on a technical and professional training. We shall not all study law or economics and so on. We need to rely on quality, skilled resources that can promote and support the growth of companies. So we need a constant training. Universities as well shall be revolutions, shall be reformed, and they shall change, because they are still too focused on power and not they're not focused enough on the real training of young people. So every single young individuals shall be trained, allowing them to do what they like the most. So that's the most important element, in my opinion. And there's also another topic that to be considered. That's to say, the freedom of choice for education for our children. Every Italian family shall be free to choose between public state and non-public state, non-public school, sorry, between public school and non-public schools. Because the service is always a public service, it's not private, which is actually performed not by the state, but by those who collaborate with the state. We talked about intermediate bodies and subsidiarities. I've been educated in a non-public school. In my family, all women used to work and are still working in the non-public school, and they contribute to educate children and students. And this is a fundamental topic for education, because each family shall be free to choose. Not only the wealthiest families shall be able to have their children attending non-public schools. So we need to guarantee a bonus, an incentive, which will prevent non-public schools to close, as it's happening, because we have a policy which is kind of preventing non-public schools to grow and develop. We have the right to have our children being educated by Christians, and the state cannot prevent that to happen by closing schools or by obliging non-public schools to close. So the state cannot impose that, because state must only guarantee education, and it shall not decide what kind of education we want for our children. That's a fundamental topic. And let me conclude. The dual system between school and jobs. It shouldn't be a joke, as it's. I think it's been the case for many years, because there may be many anecdotes of many students who didn't rely on a very good relationship between school and the labor market. So that's a fundamental topic, explaining to young people that there are educational paths which are alternative to the university, but which shall be highly qualified, because there is a huge demand from the companies. Let's just have a look at the figures. We all took part in the meeting for job consultancies, and we realized that there is a huge demand for skilled workers, but there is a huge lack of skilled workers. So there are job opportunities, but we shall have our young people ready and able to take profit of these opportunities. Matteo Salvini, I don't want to repeat what the things for which I agree, because over the last years of the pandemics, we fight the same battle in order to not to discriminate private schools against public schools, because if tomorrow all private schools had to close, I think that the national school system will completely fail. So I'm very happy that we have this freedom of choice from this point of view. Another topic that from an ideological point of view had already been fought is the empowerment of the relationship between school and the labor market. This is fundamental. And then a further couple of very practical remarks. Today, according to the data of the ministry, 57% of students are choosing the high school with the humanitarian subjects, and 13% professional schools, and the remaining part technical scientific subjects. Some parties recently said that all students should go to the liceo, so the humanitarian subjects. And I think this is a very ignorant statement, because there are many students studying tourism or catering or other technical subjects, which are very, very important. And again, the freedom of choice is fundamental. And for some parents, that's a semantic issue, because if you don't have your child attending the so-called liceo in Italy, your child is worth less than the others. But this is crazy. We need to strengthen the technical and professional approach. And then the university, talking about the university, I think that it's a proposal which has been copied by what happened abroad. And I'm sure here within the audience, we have many people who deal with this context. So I think we have a solution which costs zero. I'm talking about the university for medicine. We are lacking doctors, nurses. We are looking for them in Cuba, in Albania, in Philippines. Well, why cannot we copy the French system, where in a few weeks there will be tens of hundreds of thousands of Italians that will try to have access to the medicine university with a quiz, and just 10% of the students will pass, while in France everybody will have access to the first year of university in medicine. No one is excluded. So this, the selection is not made before starting with a test, yes or no. But the natural selection happens just after the end of the first year, based on the best marks and the real skills. Those scoring the highest marks will go ahead, and the other ones will choose other paths. And nobody will be prevented to have access to this university. Zero costs for the state, but huge benefits for the state. And then if we add a few further euros for specialization, that's it. It's going to be a huge benefit. And then we will have to deal also with the cost for purchasing new books for our children. So convincing publishing houses to reuse the same texts without changing just a few words, and asking families just to pay further 400 euros at the beginning of every school year. I think this is a very important act, a very important measure. And whenever there is no economic support enough for this, I think we shall make sure that for high schools and primary schools as well, books shall be free of charge, and this will reduce dropouts in schools. So guarantee deductibility or the free of charge school books for primary schools and high schools. I think this is fundamental.
Grazie, io penso che...
Well, I think that, of course, that this is something very serious. And we have to be responsible. We have to show responsibility towards our future. When we talk about schools, it means talking about our future, our young people. It means investing in our country. And Italy was defeated after the Second World War, obviously, being a country without oil or coal. We managed, however, to become one of the main world leading countries. And this is thanks to the willingness and sacrifice of our grandfathers and mothers, who, with great intuition, they managed to build the Italian economy that has allowed today to be still a very strong economy. And we have a very high standard of living. We have to make a choice. We know that making choices is difficult. And I'm saying this with great respect for the previous speakers also. I don't think that if you want to invest, investments are at zero cost. Actually, when you want to make an investment, it's very expensive. If you want to invest in schools, for example, it's going to be very expensive. If you want to reform schools, actually during Renzi's government a few years ago, that was a reform of the school system that was highly criticized. It had a cost of 8 billion euros, 8 billion euros spent for the school system. If we wanted to invest in education, of course, we have to spend money. There's no zero cost reform. There's no such a thing. And first of all, we will have to invest in teachers. In our history, well, in the history of Italy, teachers were always considered as key figures for the society. Nowadays, unfortunately, the salary of teachers is too low, and too many people decide to be a teacher just because they have no other options. We have to invest in it. We have to invest in universities also. Of course, we will have to make choices. It means to make choices that not everybody will agree with. We have too many universities around Italy. We have too many university faculties around Italy. We have to make choices. We have to invest in some points of excellence, universities of excellence that become attractive also for foreign students. We have to make choices that in a way will sort of revolutionize the current situation. If you want to make reforms, you will have to spend money, that's for sure. And then there's another topic, the topic of subsidiarity, not just related to schools. I'm deeply convinced, even if I always attended state schools, public schools, well, in the Italian school system and also the Italian health system, we have to respect the principle of subsidiarity. And I don't want those ideological battles that are against it. Without our subsidiarity principle in this country, the school system and also the health system wouldn't work. We wouldn't have a school system or a health system that are adequate to the current challenges. Let's commit ourselves to something. Let's say that there's a very important point of reference for this country. It's called the third sector. There are 5 million volunteers. There's 1 million employees. It is 5% of the GDP. And again, it is the third sector. So let's make investments in the third sector that allow us to invest in the school system, health system, care for the people. Let's change Well, you know, it's not just Industry 4.0. We need to have the third sector that is also 4.0 so that they can also invest in training. We need to have investment in training for the third sector. And by doing that, also the school system will improve for sure. Thank you. Giorgia Meloni. Yes, I will try to stick to the time you've given to me. Well, first of all, with regard to schools, universities, education training, I think we should make a comment about what has happened with the young generations recently. We can't just avoid recognizing that during COVID, young Italian students were devoid of everything, the right to education, right to live in the society, right to practicing sports. And we know how important that is for young people. And instead, well, they will only have to pay debt in the future. It is our responsibility to give back to these young people what was denied to them by making investments. Otherwise, we will have huge problems. I guess, well, each one of you, if you have children, you know that before the pandemic, we had, well, this young people, and I see them, four or five young people inside the same room. They don't talk to each other. They talk to each other through their mobile phone. All their life is filtered through a screen. And I think that, obviously, this has a huge impact on human relationships. We have to think about that. Otherwise, we will have some unexpected, unplanned problems in the future. Sorry to talk about this, but, well, what does that mean with regard to the school system? As Luca Ricolfi and Paola Mastrocola on a book, I can't remember the title, sorry, but anyhow, they say that the Italian school has become a machine creating inequalities. Well, if we just look around ourselves every day, we have private lessons, more and more private lessons, coaching courses. What does that mean? It means that the people who have more, well, economic opportunities will have more opportunities with regard to school, choosing the right school. So there's no equality. And now, well, we are just giving privilege to those who have more. And we have to think about that. We have a school system where, you know, to those parents, there are some parents who criticize the teachers. So they criticize the teachers if their children get a bad score. So I'm entitled to anything, to everything. I have the right for my children to get good scores always, and this is wrong. But then in many other cases, some people are victims of injustice. I think we have to work for equality and merit. We can't have merit if there's no equality in terms of equal opportunities. Your life cannot be just destined to be, marked or characterized or marked by what you inherited from your parents. So we have to demonstrate if we are good students, we deserve good scores. So I think that in Italy, we need to have grants. We need to have grants for students that allow students to study wherever they want to study. They need to have the same opportunities, even if they don't have economic resources. I think, we need, obviously, with regard to subsidiarity, I don't want to go back to that. I agree with the principles of subsidiarity. We need to reintroduce votes, scores in primary school. And I believe in the value of being judged. And we also need to have salaries in line with European salaries. I think we need more sport for everybody. Maybe you don't agree with me, but I agree. I think that sports are a driver for well-being and for, well, a correct lifestyle, a good, a fair lifestyle, and also education. Really, my time is over. Sorry, I'm not very good at sticking to the time. Well, we were talking about secondary schools, technical schools, or the so-called lyceum. Well, if you talk to the fashion industry, they will tell you that they can't find skilled workers working for the made in Italy. So I hope that the next government, and this is our project, I would like to have a liceo for the made in Italy, secondary school for the made in Italy, in order to have excellent excellence education, in order to allow people to find a job instead of giving them subsidies. Thank you.
Maurizio Lupi.
Maurizio Lupi. Well, I don't want to just go back and repeat the same things over and over. One of the main pillars for the center and right wing parties was education. We have been working on it. So I'd like to remind you that here at meeting, Sabino Cassese expressed a sentence saying we don't want to redistribute money, but rather we have to redistribute education. Mr. Draghi here at a meeting said that the main pillar we can rebuild this country on is education and research. And we shifted from 11% of resources of PNRR, the Plan for Resiliency and Recovery, to 18%.
Sintetici, il primo.
In a few words, why do we have to fight for freedom of education? It's very simple, very obvious. Schools have a task that is fundamental, that is to say, to create adults who are able to face reality. So we have to educate people. This is why we need to have the freedom of education. This is what will allow schools to reach this objective by offering a wide range of schools, state-run schools, but also private schools that have exactly the same value. A dear friend of mine, she is the director of a private secondary school. She always says, yes, private, but it has the same value. And, it's not a private, it's not private education. It is, these are schools that offer a public service, and this service has exactly the same value. So let's remember that. Secondly, school autonomy from the teaching point of view and also the economic point of view. You know, we have the objective to guarantee uniformity all around Italy, but this has not been done until now. The challenge of school autonomy, it means, that we have to fill the gap in terms of wages, salaries. The first form of investment when it comes to schools, we will have to invest in the teachers again. So masters, teachers, professors, because that's the main investment we have to make. So training, education, recruitment, judgment, and scores, and also wages, as I said. The Italian teachers get 50% less than German teachers. This means that we attach them half of the importance that Germany attaches to German teachers. And what Giorgio said, I agree. The problem is not, practice and school, what we call the apprenticeship. In Italy we have 18,000 people attending technical schools. Well, in Germany 1 million. So this is the reality, and. Something fundamental is that we should remember that in the 70s, trade unions fought a battle, the battle for 150 hours. That was a challenge, that is to say, everybody had to finish compulsory school. And today we have a very powerful automotive sector, because in Italy we believe in quality, and therefore we want to have very high quality education too. If people manage to get a high quality education, then they will have a passion for their job. They will contribute to the economics of this country, the economy of this country, and also families and children. This is all related to education. We spend 1% of our GDP in education, families, and natality, while the average in Europe is 1.8%. This means that there's a gap of 18 billion euros, and something is wrong then. We have to create an alliance in order to do better. And we have to use better the resources that we have available. We have to set priorities. For us, this is one of the main priorities. This is why we have to do something for that. We know families spend money in order to educate their children from 6 to 23 years old. And by doing that, they contribute to our society. They contribute to our country. Let's remember that.
Enrico Letta, non le piace lo sport.
Enrico Letta, don't you like sports? I don't know why of that comment. Well, I don't know. I'd like to say something about energy, actually. I heard people saying, well, the price cap, we need a European price cap. And well, if you say that, you just put the blame far away from us, saying, well, we can't have that in Italy. But what I say is that controlled prices in Italy for 12 months, by stopping that coupling between fossil fuels and renewable energy. This is actually what is causing all the problems we're having in Italy at the moment. This is something we can do now, the Italian price cap. And I want to do that. I want to do that. Let's explain this to businesses. We can't just go to them saying, we're asking to Brussels and they don't allow us. Well, you know, we can't just put the blame on somebody else always. And if we do that, we will not solve the problems. With regard to schools, the main issue for me nowadays is, first of all, the salary of teachers. We know it's been said already in our program, we say 5 years from 2022 until 27, in order to make sure that our teachers are paid exactly like the average of European teachers. In 5 years, this is possible, this is feasible. And well, here, when you are recruited, you have an initial wage that is slightly lower than the average entry wage of the other European countries, but then our wage doesn't increase. Instead, we wanted to have an increasing, a progressively increasing wage in order to make sure that our teachers' wage is in line with the other European countries after 5 years. So this is something quite important. This is my message. We all said that, but this is part of our program. We committed to doing that. The next legislation is going to be the legislation where Italian teachers will finally have a European wage. This is our promise. This is our commitment. Second point. Secondly, in my opinion, we have to have preschool compulsory. Nowadays, today, preschool is not compulsory. We need to also to prolong a compulsory school up to the age of 18. This is fundamental. This is, fundamental. Yes, we need to extend compulsory school, of course. This is fundamental. And also, preschool has to be something that is given to our families. And obviously free of charge, of course. In my opinion, our opinion, this means committing towards schools, and schools will be at the center of our investments. And a third point, which I consider as my dream, with regard to sports, I'd like to say that, if you take our program, which we have submitted, we have presented it, and Mauro Berruto is the coach of the volleyball Italian team, national team. And well, you will see that in our program, sport is considered as a tool for inclusion. I'm a very sporty person, and I think that sport is a driver for development. My dream is that in our country, and not only in our country, but also in Europe, we will manage to have the Erasmus program for secondary schools. So this is fundamental for all Italian families, not only rich Italian families that can afford it, but we would like to give this opportunity of studying in another European country as part of secondary school system, paid by our system. If we do that, we will be able to offer our students the chance to meet with another country, with students of another country, live in another country. And this is fundamental. This is a great experience if you do it when you're young. You know, the Erasmus program has always been very powerful. Sometimes it was not organized in the most efficient way, but it is the most beautiful thing we have in Europe. Let's have Erasmus program also for secondary schools. This will be great for our young people.
Luigi Di Maio per l'ultima.
Luigi Di Maio, the last answer for this turn. So everything is already been said. So let me just add that we are the second oldest country in the world. Our average is 46 years old. I'm working with some colleagues in the Minister of Foreign Affairs. Not only from the African country, where the average is 17 years old, with an average of seven children per woman, and these are incredible figures. It's just enough to think to the U.S., where the average age is 10 years less than our average age. So this means that our country shall consider young people as a treasure. They are our resource for the future, because we have less human capital for the future, and we shall invest more and more on young people. But let me add something else. Education, university, high schools, either technical or humanitarian, subjects. But the point is, where are our young people aiming at? Is a professional paid enough for his value today with respect to the European average? An employee, apart from the minimum salary level, which is important, but in terms of equity, is an employee paid for what he or she has actually been trained and educated for his experience? Well, in the majority of the cases, no. So there is a European directive that we shall comply with. We talk about fair salary and fair salary for professionals as well. These two topics are at the core of the ideas that we can develop on a young individual that decides to study. Well, then, of course, when I deal with companies, I find more and more the need for new skill people coming out from technical schools or commercial schools, and more there are companies in touch with schools in order to plan and program this education. And there is the need for education and training also for 40 or 50 years old people that have to be trained. So we need to invest on that, and we cannot do that only by investing and changing the public education. Of course, we need to create a team, a network between public school and private school, but we need to make sure there is an equal approach, because now we need, first of all, to fill a gap which has been created over the last 15 years, and then the so-called NEET, N-E-E-T, so the people not in education, employment, or training. We are talking about 2 million students that are not being educated or that are not working. And for these people, the opportunities at the local level are very important, because not only we will have to create them the opportunities, but we will have to work on a culture where this failure for them will be the end of their life. So this is not an option. They are not allowed to fail. In other parts of the country, like the Anglo-Saxon culture, for example, failure is part of the career of a person in order to come out of that failure stronger than before. But we need here to be aware that our young people, 2 million people not being neither educated nor working, it means that we have a treasure available, considering we are the second oldest country in the world, and that's where we shall keep on investing. There are new jobs. One of these is the cybersecurity, for example. We don't have a cybersecurity system in Italy. There are more and more private schools training people within this field, and it's just enough to consider the last report of the Ministry for Domestic Affairs stating that there are more and more cyber attacks growing in Italy, and we need more and more skilled people being able to do this job. So again, once again, public and private schools play a key role to create these professional roles. Thank you, Mr. Di Maio. And then again, let me start again from Mr. Di Maio with the very last question, talking about the labor market. I'd like to ask you three main questions that people, so electors, would like to have an answer for. We talk about the reddito di cittadinanza. So are we canceling that? Are we changing that? Are we keeping that? And then minimum salary level, is it something useful or not? How do we answer to companies that are facing and opposing to that? Mr. Vittadini has been talking about precarious work. So what's the balance between flexibility in terms of working relationships and the life of so many young people that have to deal with so many years of precarious works? So I'd like to ask all of you for three very accurate and specific direct answers in order to provide an answer to the people that will have to choose on the 25th of September. Well, talking about the minimum salary level, we have people in Italy earning 2 or 3 euros per hour, so we need to overcome this level. This is not dignity for a worker, but we need to impose that by law. So as we were doing with the Draghi government, we need to find an agreement in order to guarantee the dignity of a minimum salary level. And as I was saying before, we need to pay people for what they actually deserve and for their experience and their training and educational path. Then talking about the labor market and the so-called reddito di cittadinanza, well, apart from a few exceptions, we can say that the majority of the employment centers failed. So I agree with the law that's been approved in the parliament before the end of the Draghi government, which says that it's better to allow companies to directly make an offer to the people obtaining and having this reddito di cittadinanza, and if they don't accept this offer, they will be reported for that. But we need to be careful not to cancel the reddito di cittadinanza for disabled or for the weakest part of our population, that because of their condition for which they are not able to work, they cannot be punished. And let me add that all these topics shall be addressed at the European level, because we need to rely on an industrial and economic system which should be competitive. That's why, together with the European politicians, we supported the law for the fair salary, because we wanted to avoid a situation in which at the European level we would have had a country with much lower salaries, so with a risk of dumping or creating competitiveness issues to our companies. But let me add that over the last few years with the PNRR and the measures that have been taken, I think that the European level, the European Union, has been working very well. And I'm afraid to say that center-wing parties have been an obstacle to these measures sometimes. Enrico Letta. Well, first of all, reddito di cittadinanza shall be changed significantly according to the experiences. We need a measure against poverty, but in terms of jobs and the labor market, we need to rely on different initiatives. As for the minimum salary, I agree with what had been said. It's a fundamental measure in our country where there are too many industries where people are underpaid, so they're not paid enough for their dignity, but we need to correctly manage the relationships between trade unions and companies. But the key element we are dealing with is that as for the labor market, we need to make the most important choice. And our position from this point of view is that all what we can do in terms of tax reduction, so to cut taxes with the next government, should be implemented in order to reduce taxes for the workers, to reduce the tax wedge in order to allow the employer to guarantee a salary which shall be more, let's say, solid of what we have today. If we won't succeed in doing that with a revolutionary choice, allowing employer to guarantee more jobs, with longer-term jobs and to the workers to rely on a better salaries, we won't have a good future. I think that one of the mistakes we made to stop the Draghi government is that the Draghi government decided to cut taxes for the work, that if we allowed that to actually succeed, by the end of this year, we would have guaranteed basically one further month of salary for every worker. So I believe that it's been a huge mistake to interrupt the Draghi government. But however, we need to go ahead with this approach, with this idea, which is absolutely fundamental. And let me also add that tax reductions and tax incentives in our country should be focused on workers and on the labor market. Too often we incentive the financial world and not the labor market. Of course, the finance plays a key role, but if we need to make a choice, I'm sure we need to prioritize the labor market, both for men and women that are working and also for young people. And let me spend the last minute talking about that. We need to fight against precarious works and jobs. And that's one of the key topics for our agenda. This was one of the reasons why I get back to work in the politics. I remember many young people were coming and asking me, what's the reason for me to come back to Italy? Because if I work abroad, the first contract I get, it's a very well-paid contract allowing me to buy a house. If I come back to Italy, the first contract I get is a free contract internship. So we want to completely cancel free internships, which are one of the worst things that our country implemented and developed over the last few years. So the first working experience shall be paid. And we cannot accept that so often young students are happy because they got a job offer where they, if according to their skills and their education, and when they are asked what's the salary, the answer is, well, we didn't discuss about that, this will come later. That's not acceptable. This is at the core of the labor market. So for us, the choice is the first work shall be paid with dignity, and we shall completely cancel free internships and stages. So this is the key element to allow our children, our young people, to stay in Italy, to work in Italy, and not to have to move abroad in order to find a job.
Oh, per flash.
Well, okay, so minimum wage. As I said, well, you know, the problem of wages is a huge problem. We all know that in Italy we've always had this problem, that which couldn't be solved only with a minimum wage. We know that, well, we have the national labor agreements, and they already have their own minimum wage defined. So I think that The problem of the labor market is a different one in Italy. There's only one way to increase wages in Italy, by reducing labor taxes. The Draghi's government anticipated the tax reform. They had 8 billion euros in order to cut taxes. We tried to explain. We said, when you don't have a lot of resources, 8 billion euros is not a lot, you need to concentrate it. And we made a proposal, that is to say, to cut the tax level by 5%. So our proposal was to reduce taxes on workers and also on the businesses, 1/3 on the businesses and 2/3 on the workers. But a different choice was made. Our proposal was not accepted. So as I said, I think that if we talk about minimum wage, we will not solve the problem. We have to talk about the tax wedge. With regard to professionals, well, because, as I said, I think that minimum wage will not be the solution to the problem. But, well, we should talk about self-employed people, freelancers and self-employed people. Well, I think that everybody deserves to find the job they are passionate for and what they studied for. We would like to approve a change regarding self-employed. We also need a system of social shock absorbers. And well, with regard to the so-called reddito di cittadinanza, so citizens' income allowances, well, the Pope, John Paul II, came here and he said to the meeting, he said, things are resources for human beings only when human beings meet them through work. So the Pope, Pope John II, tried to explain that work is not just based on money. It is the value of your participation in the national community. I think that the current citizenship income allowance is based on something wrong. That is to say, it puts on the same level those who don't want to work and those who can't work. If you do that, it will have a negative impact on the weakest. The paradox is that we give up to 780 euros to a young boy, 20 years old, in good health, when a disabled people, old, elderly disabled people, gets a much lower pension in Italy. I think this is not fair. The second point, well, and this is why I was mentioning the Pope, John II, is, well, the reason why I mention him is that what I don't believe in is, well, when you tell young people, well, just stay at home, I don't need you, and you give them that allowance. This is a country that was founded by very young people. If you want to help young people to have a better future, you should give those resources to those who are going to employ them. You have to convince people to work, because work has a dignity and gives dignity to people. There's no job that doesn't give dignity to people. You see, I meet many young people who would like to have a better job, more adequate to their education, and we will commit ourselves to doing that. But you see, instead of staying at home and getting the income allowance, well, I'm sure, I have no doubt, I would much better prefer to have a job for which I didn't study. I worked as a waitress for many years, but working as a waitress when I was jobless before getting into politics, and that gave me dignity. I mean, it allowed me to get an income. Our proposal is, of course, finding the right resources, giving money to people who need money, because they have old people at home, ill people at home, but no citizenship income allowance. Thank you. And actually, I'd like to say something that is going to be central for the future of this country. I think, well, we don't have to be demagogic. Well, we don't want a demagogy. We don't want to continue thinking that there's a clash between businessmen and workers. You know, nowadays, employers know that the very first asset they have, specifically in a country like ours, are exactly the workers, the employees, the workers that work in their company. I know many entrepreneurs who have defended at all costs their workers during the pandemic. They did everything they could in order not to let them go. And well, the fact that there should be social class fight has to be overcome. We need to find the right tools. We need to find the incentives, allowances. We need to increase them in order to make sure that the minimum wage is a wage agreed on between companies and workers. Because, well, we want to fight against the black market, the hidden market that is enormously present in this country, both in the north and also in the south of Italy. And, well, you can't fight against that with the minimum wage. We have a lot of submerged economy that, well, steals resources from the public sector. It steals services from the third sector, from the country. So I think that the black market is what we have to fight against. We have to be aware of the fact that we need to invest energy and resources in that fight. The young people and the citizenship income allowance. I think this is a very wrong measure because, well, of course, if we want to fight against poverty, you don't fight against it only with money. And, well, we all know that it's not enough to give money to a poor person in order to allow that person to go out of his or her condition. Poverty requires a set of services. So only the public local bodies and the third sector can act together in order to fight against poverty. Money is not enough. And the citizenship allowance has interrupted that mechanism. It is true that work is a right, but it's also a duty. The state cannot continue financing those people who will not have the pleasure to work, the pleasure to grow. Young people that don't work will not grow. Individual growth is not just based on school, but also on work. I agree with Giorgia Meloni when she was talking about her experience when she was younger as a waitress. All of us had well to look for the first job, and our first job or jobs really helped us grow. We have to go out of this welfareism culture that was introduced by introducing the citizenship allowance. We want to take care of everybody. Nobody will have to be will be left behind. We want to abolish the citizenship allowance by introducing new laws and new norms in favor of insertion into the labor market, reducing taxes, and also reducing the cost of work for companies. Our proposal is that for those who are less than 25 years old, no taxes will be paid for them. Because, you know, there's we don't want any tax to be paid for that generation. And only by doing that, we'll fight against the labor market. With regard to energy, Enrico, I'd like to say something to you, referring to the price cap. Well, let's go out of any demagogy. The Lazio region imposed some limitations that didn't allow to build photovoltaic plants and alternative energy sources. Our gas fields, our gas in Emilia Romagna is not being used due to demagogy. We have lost or missed 1,000 jobs in Emilia Romagna due to that. So, of course, I also agree with regard to the nuclear energy. We can't be the only country not having nuclear sources. With regard to energy, we can't have any demagogy. And the same also applies to the labor market. Matteo Salvini.
Grazie, complimenti per la resistenza a chi è qua e a chi è in collegamento.
Well, thank you for staying with us. Thanks. Well, you've been very patient to stay with us until now. a few proposals for our elections on the 25th of September, and we will meet again next year. You will tell us if the winners of the elections have kept their promises. Proposal number one, we've been listening to the labour market and to businesses. We know that well, we have to reduce taxes. We want to pay extra hours, and we also want to give bonuses to workers. If I want to give you a bonus of 1,000, well, we can't pay taxes on that, and that will be free of charge to the state. And citizenship income allowances, 72% of those who started, 70% of the people who applied for that in 2019, they are starting to have it now. And well, you know, 17% of the people that, that are getting it have at least one disabled people in their family, so they need to keep it. And then, well, you know, otherwise for most of the others, we will just will not pay that allowance to them. In 21, 9 billion euros was paid as citizenship allowances. Well, you know, instead, we know that many families are getting less money now for their children with the so-called assegno unico or family bonus for families that are that have children. They are getting less money at the moment for the family allowance, so we should change that. Flat tax and pension reform. The flat tax is already a reality nowadays. Today, 2 million freelancers or self-employed who get up to 65,000 euros as an income, they pay well a flat tax already. So those that want to be self-employed, they only pay 15% on their income nowadays. The League is proposing to increase from 65,000 to 75,000. Sorry, 100,000. And well, we would like to have the flat tax also for families and for employees. So the flat tax, in other words, the flat tax is not just for Berlusconi or billionaires. In our law proposal or in our draft bill that we have already submitted, we also would like to extend that to families, single income people or families, one income, and also two income families up to 70,000 euros income. 70,000 income before tax is not being reached, so you can really be helped by the flat tax. We would like, again, as I said, we would like to extend the flat tax to well, people who are getting a pension and to retired people, to families. The cost would be 13 billion euros for the first year. 9 billion euros have already been allotted. So again, the flat tax is something we would like to extend from self-employed people to employees also. Pensions, from the 1st of January 23, the Fornero law will come back. So people will retire when they are 66 years old. The oldest in Europe, after 3 years of COVID, with this economic crisis and the current war, increasing by 5 years, the pension age would be crazy. And there are people, there are some trade unions, actually, CGL, and I read that on La Repubblica newspaper. Well, you know, there is a certainly not a far-wing newspaper, sorry, a right-wing newspaper. And well, the so-called quota 41 would cost 1,300,000 euros, and in 3 years' time, it would also give the possibility to retire, to choose to retire to 800,000 workers. So after paying, well, you know, after paying taxes for 41 years. I think, well, everybody after paying taxes for 41 years, I think this is a right for everybody. And last thing I'd like to say, in Emilia Romagna, you know, they have eliminated the vouchers for agriculture and tourism, but I think we should reintroduce it from tomorrow. It's much better to have a short-time job, temporary job, instead of working in the black market. So I think that the Fornero law cannot come back. Tajani?
Non ci si può.
We cannot talk about the labor market if we don't support those that create jobs. I'm talking about companies, and I'm talking about freelancers. So that's why we need in our country a real policy for the growth, investing on industry, companies, agriculture, trade. If there's no global vision, which shall start from a reduction of taxes for sure for the people that are working and on the businessmen, on the companies that are running risk as well, we cannot think about having a growing policy which promotes and supports the labor market. We need to rely on the real economy. We cannot think that because of the climate change we can destroy our industry. When I see at the European level that there are some forces working in order to stop the production of non-electrical cars starting from 2035, wasting hundreds of thousands of jobs, I think there's no industrial policy there. There's no policy supporting the workers. When I see that also our agricultural industry is in danger because of wrong choices, there is no real protection of the environment, because the farmers are the first protectors for the environment, and we need to be clear about that. So, considering that we are the second manufacturing country in Europe, we need to rely on a strategic vision, investing on the growth, supporting industries, small and medium companies, and our party, Forza Italia, has been supporting that approach, and we have Maurizio Casaschi, who is the president of the association, supporting that, and we want to provide this signal to the companies, small and medium enterprises. And we need to cut the taxes once again to guarantee that all these industries will be allowed to grow. Then talking about the so-called reddito di cittadinanza, we have already been very clear about that. The state shall support those who are not able to work. We need to grow minimum pensions and support old people and disabled people, but we need also to work in order to guarantee a work on to those who are able to work. And too often there are people not allowed, that are not able to recruit young people because they are getting the reddito di cittadinanza. They're asking for being paid within the black labor markets. This is not acceptable. If you have a job, you are free. If you are getting the reddito di cittadinanza, you are not free. And there are also contradictions about that. Is it true that a person able to work, maybe with two children, are getting 1,300 euros with the reddito di cittadinanza, and they are earning more than a professor, more than a policeman, or a someone that every day is risking their life in order to guarantee our safety? So is it right or not? I don't think it's something good. I don't think it's something right, because in this way, policemen, professor, teachers, and other people will not be motivated to go to work. My daughter asking me why she'll wake up every morning at 6 a.m. to go to teach a school and get 800 euros per month, while if I get the reddito di cittadinanza, I will maybe earn more. So of course, this is a provocation. She will never do that. But that's a wrong approach and the role of the state is wrong as well here, because the state shall behave as an example, so helping those who actually have problems, but also allowing those who are able to work to have the opportunity to work. That's why we need to invest on the support of small and medium enterprises and the agricultural policies as well and industrial policies. Maurizio Lupi, in conclusion, as a president of the Intergroup, and then finally Mr. Vittadini, in conclusion. Since I've been able for 5 years in the Parliament to talk just for a couple of minutes, I'll try to be brief just in a couple of minutes to thank the Intergroup, first of all. So three main examples. First of all, a businessman I met in Bergamo 1 week ago in order to show you one of our main principles. He told me, I don't want any kind of help from the state. I have 100 employees. I want, considering the inflation, which is accounting for 10%, so 140 euros less in the salary, I want to be allowed to increase the salaries with no constraints, because if I want to add 200 euros net price to my employees, it will cost me 500 euros actually. So that's the way we should go through. If we want to allow this to happen, we shall cut the costs and taxes to those who want to increase salaries. And one public euro, should be multiplier for public resources, enhancing public resources. Then bureaucracy, we need to simplify our bureaucracy, to reduce our bureaucracy. Bureaucracy is costing us 57 billion euros to the world of companies, and we are wasting huge amount, 127 billion euros. Third element, circular economy and development. Well, the main example that I noticed is over the last few months is what is happening in Rome about the landfill. What happens there in Rome? There are people that are living with a journey of more than 1,000 kilometers in order to bring our waste there to be incinerated. So what's the best way to protect our environment? Is it correct to have these trucks going through this long journey just to incinerate our wastes? And then I think that for the next program we need to invest the right amount of money for people and for active policies, for sure. So let me conclude by thanking all the groups that took part in our activities over the last 5 years. And let me thank a person who is not here with us, is Gabriele Toccafondi. So a round of applause for him, please, because I'm sure he is looking at us from remote now. Thanks to the Foundation for Subsidiarity, we already identified the three topics: labor market, education, school. For the next government, I think it's going to be fundamental to work together. This, of course, starting from our diversity in terms of reforms from the electoral law and constitutional reforms. I think this is a commitment for all of us. Thank you. Giorgio Vittadini, in conclusion. Well, it's going to be impossible to sum up. And it's not fine, because each one of us is free to decide. But something happened today with diversity for the common good. I would like to thank all our speakers here, because they really showed what politics is and what a party is for the community, because they had a debate, an open debate, sharing their ideas, but in a very collaborative way. So again, I'd like to thank them with a round of applause, because this is an answer to the topic of disaffection towards politics, because it does not mean being naive. We need to rely on open-mindedness and we need to be brave. What we saw today, if once this happens, this is a restart for the parties. There's opportunity for a real dialogue where we also took part in with our rounds of applauses, because it's been a dialogue, a real dialogue. And the second thing I'd like to tell you concerns all of us. This is not enough. We interviewed them, but if there is no participation with a bottom-up approach, they won't be able to succeed. This depends on us. So stop saying that politics is bad, and so on and so forth. We need to commit. It's our task today to be curious and to participate, asking questions. We cannot say that if they do something, we will do something later. No, we need to move before. We need to start moving before. We need to take part in this process, in this dialogue. We need and we want, together with them, to fight against this disaffection in order to build Italy all together. Today, we had a very good example for all our country, for all of us. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you once again to all of you. Thanks to all our guests. And thanks to all of you for having been here with us until now. Once again, I would like to meet all of you here next year, as Matteo Salvini said, to check how far we are. And then a very final remark. There are the Donate Now desks for those of you who want to help the meeting, which is a wonderful organizational machine allowing this event. Thank you once again.
Civiltà dell'amore, fratelli e sorelle, costruite senza stancarvi mai questa civiltà. Lavorate per questo, pregate per questo, soffrite per questo.
Abbiamo sfidato un monitor quando tutto era virtuale. Ora siamo qui, insieme, pronti a ritrovarci là fuori, dentro alla vita. Abbiamo sfidato un monitor quando tutto era virtuale. Ora siamo qui, insieme, pronti a ritrovarci là fuori, dentro alla vita.